Should you buy an Apple Watch? You know, if you're a geek and interested in that kind of watch and you've been wanting to buy one, I think I'm going to give you a good reason to justify it. It has to do with stroke. See, there's a thing called atrial fib. It is atrial fibrillation. It is by far the most common heart dysrhythmia that we see. It happens more in 50 and 60 year olds, and it multiplies our risk for stroke by a factor of 5. It was a stroke of unknown origin. There were several different names for it. And what we found was these people had atrial fib, but it was paroxysmal. In other words, it just happened every now and then. They didn't know it. We didn't know it. Occasionally, they would feel a little bit of flutter in their chest, but they would ignore it and move on. Then we'd find out later they had atrial fib. See, what happens is there's an area where blood pools in what's called the auricle of the atria. Blood can pool there if the atria is not contracting and squeezing it all out. And that can cause a clot. So the Apple Watch actually looks for atrial fib. And here's a study. Now you say, okay, you know, it's some silly study. And we've seen this before. New England Journal? I don't think you've seen it before, and it's not silly. It's real. This actually ushers in a whole new area. In 8 months, they recruited over 400,000 participants to this study. They had zero study centers. It was all done online. It's just like my telemedicine practice. So here we go with the article. New England Journal, November 14th, 2019. Large-scale assessment of smartwatch to identify atrial fib. Now, some cardiologists have criticized it, and they said, you're just going to pick up a bunch of the worried well with young people. We'll talk about that in a few minutes, too. Background optical sensors on these watches can detect irregular pulses. The participant without atrial fib, as reported by the participants themselves, used a smartphone to say, okay, if I get a warning from my smartphone that I may have this, I'll write in. They will give me a Holter monitor, and they will wear it for 7 days. 7 days is a key point, too. It has to do with false positives. In other words, if somebody didn't come up positive on that Holter monitor, does that mean the atrial fib was not true on the Apple Watch? No. But we'll get to that a little bit later. Again, large study, 8 months, 420,000 participants, 117 days. It didn't take long to get this study done, again, and it was a huge one. Now, atrial fib was present in 34% of the people that had been notified. Now, it turned out to be like, what, 400 or so? It wasn't that many, because the vast majority of these people were young people, and they never got notified. So that's a comment to the cardiologists who are saying this is going to get the worried well and fill up the already overtaxed medical community. No, it's not. It's not going to picking up young people. So here's the other thing. Conclusions, what did they find? The probability of receiving an irregular pulse warning from the Apple Watch was low. The probability, if you went ahead and sent in your information and got the 7-day Holter monitor, was pretty high at a third. And as we mentioned, false positives maybe really aren't false positives because of that whole thing with paroxysmal atrial fib. It goes away and then comes back. So we see that all the time. We see that with 2-3 week and even 1 month long Holter monitors, that they had symptoms, we think they had atrial fib, but we just didn't pick it up on the Holter monitor during those 2 weeks to a month that they were wearing it. So, as we said, it's important to know if you have it. It quintuples your risk of stroke. Now, what do you do for that? We'll talk about that a little bit later, too. So, again, we've basically covered most of this information, 420,000, about 400 out of the total picked up, 400 new cases of atrial fib, people that had 5 times risk for stroke, didn't know it. And again, as you see in this picture, I'm going to skip over that picture. and go to this one. This shows basically, again, the groups that actually had atrial fib, the ones that got notices were in the 55 and older, especially the older than 65 age group. It detected other things too, but the bottom line was it detected atrial fib, and that's what we want. I asked the question, well, what do you do for it? One thing is obesity. Another is high blood pressure. Another is sleep apnea. All these things greatly increase your body's time in fibrillation if you do have fibrillation. Actually, if I get typically weigh around 155 to 160, if I start getting over 160 pounds, my atrial fib kicks up. When we did a Holter monitor on mine, I was at 30% fibrillation. Now, the cardiologist wanted to do an ablation on me, but I know a little bit more about this than your average patient, and I also know that I'm homozygous, 4q25. I've got both genes which tend to take my heart muscle and turn it from muscle into more of a conduction system. In other words, it helps create all of these short circuit my atria. So these things, typically these ablations last, and let me go up and find in a picture of an ablation. An ablation is where they go in and they basically cauterize or burn an area around the space where these tend to come in the pulmonary arteries. These ablations typically often will work. They'll take a couple of hours to get the thing done, and they'll last like 2 years. My mother had it. Remember, I'm homozygous, so that means I got one 4Q25 gene from my mom, one 4Q25 gene from my dad, and my mom has had atrial fib for years, a couple of decades. She's had 4 ablations because, yeah, she'll have them. I mean, that's just typical of what happens. She'll have them, then she'll grow some more short circuits, and then she'll go back into atrial fib. So what do? Lose that weight. I declined getting the ablation. I lost weight, and my symptoms went away. Make sure you manage that blood pressure. Make sure you get good sleep and exercise. Now, don't exercise too much. And be careful with prolonged endurance exercise. That was another thing that probably contributed to mine. I've run half marathon a week, and that was in addition to playing 3 to 6 full hours of full court basketball a week. And that was in my 40s and 50s. And we didn't really know that kind of endurance training was that much of a risk for atrial fib back at that point in time. I wish we had known. Now, so again, you want to get that exercise, you want to get the weight loss, you want to manage your diet, manage your blood pressure, manage your sleep, but be careful being one of those marathon level and sort of stuff, endurance training. If you've made it this far, thank you very much for your interest, and consider getting that Apple Watch.
We continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars, and here's why. You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks.